Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review on car jump starters, in particular the kind of mini portable ones. So just a note up front, there is going to be a fair bit of chit chat through this video because as I've discovered, there are lots of things you need to be wary of with these devices. There could be risks in terms of having them in your car. Three of the six that I tested failed, and failed in not a nice way. There was definitely snap, crackle and pop involved. So if you don't want to go through all the chit-chat and an in-depth understanding of these devices, what you need to be aware of, I'm going to post a link here to my website where you can go and look at a table, and straight away from that table you can see how these devices performed, which failed and which might be the best for your car or what have you. And then I'm also going to follow up with a second video which will also be uniquely available at that link, where I go and test these on a vehicle and try and start that vehicle with these devices and to see how many times it will start. For the testing that I did, I used a carbon pile load tester, which isn't the same as a car starting, but I wanted to test some of their particular claims. So if you want to see that video, again, it'll be at this link. Right, so let's get into the discussion on these devices. So first off, let me just quickly introduce them and tell you which ones were sent to me and which ones I purchased. The two that were sent to me by Chinese companies, this one called Archeer, okay, which failed, and one called BezTech. Now, all of these devices are available on Amazon. They range in price from around $63 to $100. So these two failed. Then the one that I purchased some time ago for the USB power bank test as a wild card, it is the Bolt Power. It also failed. I then have the Anker. This passed and for, on the most part, achieved as well as it could according to its claims. And we're going to talk about that. One of the safest devices, and safety is a big concern with these devices, but one of the safest devices was this GB40 NOCO Genius Boost. Safe, but didn't deliver nearly what they claim in terms of the current output for starting a motor. And then what I purchased as a kind of benchmark, which I thought would be the kind of benchmark I was judging these against, was a Stanley Jumpit. So this is the kind of device that you perhaps have in your garage ready in case you need to jumpstart a car rather than something that you'd keep in your car. And I thought this would definitely have the oomph to kind of benchmark against, but it also fell very short of its claims. However, it didn't fail and it seems to be fairly well built. So let's get into the discussion of these devices and what they need to do. Why do you need one of these jumpstart devices? Well, it's insurance. If you're out there, and particularly where this is going to happen is potentially in winter, when things get cold, your car is hard to start, that's when your battery may struggle if it's at the weekend, or if you've gone and perhaps left your lights on or something like that, you're going to be in a situation where you need to jumpstart your car. Now, rather than relying on someone with a set of jumper cables, if you've got one of these devices, supposedly you can just connect it up to your battery, jumpstart your car, and off you go. But there are many caveats to that, which I want to discuss. So the one thing to be aware of, that starting a car, you require a lot of current. The amount of amps that you need to start a car, let's say for a small car, can range in the order of 50, 60 amps. In the summer, when let's say the oil is thick and the engine can turn over easily, there's not a lot of resistance. Let's say that same small car might need 100 amps or 120 amps. I tested a 3.5 liter V6, which believe it or not, here in the States would be a kind of mid-size engine. You're gonna get the larger diesel and larger V8 4 liter, 5 liter engines, which are going to require far more amps, but we'll use this 3.5 liter V6 as a kind of go-to measure. That engine, when I started it, and I'm going to put up a photograph showing you, I had a clamp meter. You'll see the amps are the wrong way around because I had the clamp inverted so I could film it. That engine peaked at 668 amps. Now that peak is that immediate inrush current, which is going to happen. It then steadied to around 250, dropping off to 200 amps before the engine was started. Very short duration, only about a second. So if you've got a good healthy engine and the conditions aren't too bad, now I started that as about 5 degrees Celsius, so fairly cold, but that started with those requirements. It needed that 250 amp. In the summertime, that engine perhaps may only need around 200 amps. But Sod's law is that you're going to be caught out in bad conditions in the cold, and you are going to rely on a lot of current to start your car. Now, another thing to be aware about is the voltage. It doesn't just come down to the current. When you crank and start your car, the voltage is going to drop on your battery under load. Now, a healthy battery where you haven't got too much resistance on the starter motor, you're going to be looking at between 9 and 10 volts. So normally your battery might be sitting at, let's say, 12.5 if you've got a few ancillaries loading it slightly. If it's really healthy, perhaps around the 13 mark. But it's going to drop from that 13, 12.5 down to 9, 10 volts under load. If you're looking at crank amps or cold crank amps, now these are specific terms and standards which rate how well or how many amps the battery can deliver to crank an engine. These are specific tests. For the crank amps, that is governed at a temperature of 0 degrees Celsius or around 32 Fahrenheit, that it needs to be able to do the crank amp rating of the battery. And let's say you can have a battery with, let's say, that is rated for 500 crank amps. Now they may specify crank amps or cold crank amps, CCA. We're going to talk about that now. Now that rating means it needs to be able to deliver that 500 crank amps for 30 seconds and not drop below 7.2 volts. So why the 7.2 volts? You're going to get to a point where even though you might have the current, your starter motor still needs a minimum voltage to turn over, because ultimately it's the power that it's going to rely on, the combination of the current and the voltage. And once the voltage drops too low, it's not going to start. And that 7 volts is roughly a standard that I took, that I kind of measured current at a minimum level that these were required to deliver. Now, if we're looking at cold crank amps, so there you're looking at, I think it's minus 18 degrees Celsius, around 0 Fahrenheit. That's really cold, but those are the conditions that a battery needs to start a car at. There, it's that those crank amps need to deliver at that temperature, and again for 30 seconds. Now, for the proper test, they actually put a battery under those cold conditions for 24 hours before they test them. Now, I'm not going to judge these devices against that, but one does need to have some realistic level to judge them against if they are going to start an engine. Now, I'll take just as an example, this Noco Genius Boost. It says it's rated for 1,000 amps. If we go to the Anker, it is rated for 300/600 amps. So here, at least they quote the kind of nominal crank amps and then peak amps. Here on the Noco Genius Boost, all they're quoting is the peak amps. So by assumption, we can assume that the normal crank amps that they should be able to deliver is around 500. But that is an assumption because they don't state it. But on all the other devices, basically, if you halve the peak, you get to their normal quoted crank amps. Now, to start a car, as I stated, the 3.5 liter engine that I tested started within about 1 second. So if you're looking at a healthy engine, you would expect it to start within 1 to 2.5 seconds. That's a reasonable amount of time. But if you've got an engine which is, let's say you've come back from vacation, your car's been standing for a few weeks, the voltage on your battery has dropped a bit, perhaps the fuel in the fuel line has evaporated, you could be sitting there cranking from anywhere between 5 to 10 seconds before the car eventually takes. Now, you don't want to go much beyond 10 seconds because then you are seriously putting a lot of load on the systems, the battery, the wiring, etc. in your vehicle. So once you've cranked for like 8 to 10 seconds, you want to sit back and give it a rest. So for my testing, I would like to have thought that these would deliver their kind of stated crank amps for at least 5 seconds. I would have thought would have been a reasonable request. So that's what I wanted to judge them on. They quote where they do quote, let's say for the peak current, they will quote that it can hold the peak current for 3 seconds. Now, after my testing, I realized that is not realistic at all, because if it can hold the peak current for 3 seconds, you're talking, let's say, the 600 amp or the 1000 amp, it should be able to hold its crank amps for about 5 or 6 seconds. None of these were able to do this. At best, 1 second or 1.5 seconds is what they kind of managed to hold. And even then, the voltage was just dropping. So that was a challenge with these devices. So why, if you go and look at other reviews of these devices, or you read the reviews, if you can find genuine reviews on Amazon, you'll see people saying, yes, it started my Ford F-150. Yes, it started my car. Why? If you have one of these and you have a battery where the voltage has just dropped below a certain level, so it's got reduced energy in it, the battery voltage is at a lower level. If you put this in parallel with that battery, the full requirement of this device is not required. Part of the load is going to come from the battery, part of it is going to come from here. And then in most cases, as long as this thing is not too foul or you've got a major problem with resistance on the starter motor, the car should start. But then this is not truly jump-starting the car per se. It's boosting, it's helping as a boost in parallel with a battery. So for me, a true test is, let's say you've given one of these to your wife or your daughter as a present to help her out in case she's in a bad situation. It's the middle of winter, she's in a car park after work, she left her headlights on by mistake. It's about 0 degrees Celsius, she goes out and realizes there is no power whatsoever left in her battery. It's cold, it's late at night. Now you are totally reliant on the crank amps and voltage provided by this. Will it start the car? And that for me is a real challenge. And that's where often many of these will fall over, as you'll see in the testing. So that's enough talking about the requirements. You can see they can be fairly harsh requirements under certain situations. In theory, you should be able to connect, literally disconnect your battery, connect your battery solely to one of these. And if they deliver the amps that they are quoting, it should start your car. Ha ha. The next biggest issue is safety. Now, what I want to read to you as we go into safety in particular, because I know the companies that have sent me these devices are going to watch this video. And of course, I'm totally not going to recommend these devices, or in fact, the one that I purchased, because I would consider them unsafe. And there's also a question even with these other devices, which we're going to talk about in terms of their safety. But in order for these to be safe, they need to have a good set of cables and croc clips, protect against reverse polarity. So one thing I didn't check against. Certainly they need to protect themselves in terms of overload. And I just want to read you something. So this is the Archer of Amazon. And I'm just going to read what it says in terms of the advanced safety. It says, and I quote, "Unlike cheaper variations, multiple safety protections are in place to protect your car and the jump starter, saving you thousands in accidental damage." Okay, so that is the Archer, which failed. Then we get to the BezTech. It says safety protection. Smart jumper cable ensures total protection against short circuits, provides total protection for your jump starter and car battery as well. So now I highlight that in particular. All the devices in fact claim some kind of safety, but they make a case in point about how safe it is. It's going to protect you, save you thousands. As you'll see from the video when we get down to the testing, and I can still smell that wonderful burnt smell on this device, the Archer, they have these kind of so-called smart cables. And again, in terms of judging quality, some of these croc clips and what have you aren't the best. They use perhaps a thinner cable. Now these cables, in terms of handling hundreds of amps, certainly if you're gonna handle hundreds of amps for a long duration, these aren't gonna work. The peak current, your car is only going to draw that high peak for milliseconds, not a long time. So handling the peak current isn't such an issue. It's those hundreds of amps for perhaps 5 or 10 seconds where these will heat up. Now, what these smart cables are supposed to do with this nice little electronic box and the little LED is, for one, prevent short circuits, which for the most part they do. I tested all of these. In fact, the only one which failed was the one that I purchased, this Bolt Power. It claims short circuit protection. There's no switch on these to switch them on and off in the unit themselves, something I'm going to talk about. You have to open a little rubber stopper, which provides some protection, and then get to a high current socket plug point in there. But that is live. And with the Bolt Power, if you are walking around, your wife or your girlfriend is walking around, or your daughter for that matter, and these clink together and some of them expose metal, which it is partially there, you have to be careful, you're gonna get a big spark. Or if they accidentally hook them up to let's say the body of the car by accident, you're going to get a huge discharge of current and sparks. You don't want that. So for the most part, these offer that protection in these devices. But on the Archea, this, when I loaded it up, started melting and smoking. So that was a fail. On the BezTech, it uses, I believe, these two devices, the Archea and the BezTech, have got the same electronics. The smart start cables look exactly the same. The start voltage, which was very high, 15.78 volts, which to me is a concern. You don't have a voltage that high. It could potentially cause an issue with the electrics in the car. In theory, your battery will pull that voltage down, but there might be certain situations where that might be an issue. This device, once I put it under heavy load, started swelling up and popped. Whoa! So it's kind of advanced smart protection, non-existent in my test across both of these. The same happened for the Bolt Power that I purchased after several tests. And the interesting thing was, although for my initial test, when I wasn't trying to load them too much, I'd crank up the load for about, I would say, anywhere between 5 to 8 seconds and then take it back down. I didn't want to stress things too much, but at the same time, I also did want to see whether they at least protected themselves. So I'd crank it up, and I found that in those later tests, when I was holding the load just for a little bit longer, remember, these should be able to deliver those crank amps for at least 5 to 6 seconds. But at that point as well, this started swelling, the battery in this started swelling up. You could hear it creaking in the video. Now, the one issue I have with these kind of smart cables is that your protection is in the cable, not at this device. If for any reason this happened to flap open and touch anything, and you short over here against all of these devices, barring the kind of genius boost, then you'll have a big short and big energy being released. Not a good idea. The two devices, the one, the Stanley Jumpit, has got a manual switch, so you're not gonna have any risk of shorting as long as you've got that manual switch switched off. But of course, once that is switched on, it's live, there's no intelligence. But the Genius Boost has the safety built into the device. The port will not short unless you override it by pushing a button on the device. And that's what I in particular liked about this one. So those are the issues. The other issue I have with these devices, some of them you need to connect in different ways. Some of them want the cables connected to the battery pack prior to starting the car. Some want you to connect the crocodile clips and then connect the battery pack. So how do you know that? And this is the gripe I have with all of these devices. They come with these chintzy little manuals with small print. Now, you can imagine if your daughter or poor wife is sitting there in the freezing cold, dark winter, late at night, and you expect them to fish out a manual like this and try and read broken English to understand whether they're going to be connecting the device correctly or not. Not a great idea. That's why you want a device which is going to be easy to operate and safe, and that's where I think this Genius Boost wins, although again, lack of performance in terms of current delivery. And I think what these devices should do, Anker does it best in their manual. Anker have a very simple manual. It's a few fold-out pages with diagrams to show you what to connect and how to connect it. But even there, I'd say late at night, someone panicking is not going to whip out this diagram on how to do it. These devices should have the instructions clearly printed on them. Pictorial, not written, pictorial. Step one, step two, do this, push this button, crank your car. That's what it should be. Fail safe and easy to use. Anyway, enough of my rant. I said I was just a little bit shocked in terms of the safety issues. One other thing I want to point out before I play the video on the testing is that these come with various ways to recharge them. I've noted that in the table that's on my spreadsheet. Some have got external AC adapters that go from AC to 15 volt DC. Again, the Genius one has actually got a USB charging. So it comes with a little USB adapter, USB cable, 5 volt into it. Clever. No silly proprietary external adapter. You've probably got USB in your car to charge your phone. You can use that or the adapter that they provide. Here comes the other safety warning with these lithium batteries. You do not want to leave these charging indefinitely. The one risk with having these in your vehicle is that over time they might slowly discharge. Now, I tested the power bolt after it had been in my car for a long time and it still was at a very good level. So I think the level of discharge is not going to be high, but you probably want to check them every 6 months to 12 months at least. When spring or summer comes along, whip it out, take it into your house and charge it. Don't leave it in your car charging. If one of these bursts and ignites, that's at your car. You want it somewhere where you can observe it so that you can be assured that it's charging safely. Store it in your car in the coolest spot possible, underneath the seat or underneath in your boot somewhere where it doesn't get hot. Lithium batteries and heat do not mix well, and that is my other concern. Do you really want one of these in your vehicle with a lithium battery inside on a really, really hot summer's day? I can't answer that for you. I'm busy weighing that up myself. I would much rather have, let's say this one will have a lead acid battery inside it that it's using to provide its power. I'd much rather have that solution, but it's big, of course, and these are small. Anyway, let's go and watch the videos. You'll see for the first one, I sat there with a stopwatch thinking I was going to time it. What I wanted to do was take the load right up to see if I could get to the maximum crank amps, not a peak. There's no ways I was going to be able to test the peak. I think all of these would deliver their claimed peak. It's very easy to deliver 1,000 amps for a fraction of a second. It's a sustained crank amps, which is a challenge, and that's what I wanted to test. So on the load, I dialed it up. I wanted to get to the maximum, and then what I wanted to do was hold it there for 5 seconds. Not a chance. Didn't need my stopwatch after the first test. It was just a challenge to crank it up, see what I could get a maximum reading, then reduce it and try and hold it to see what the level would be around 7 volts to make a note of that. And that current was lower than the other current, even though I had heavier load, because by that time, the energy level just couldn't sustain the current load. So I made a note of the maximum and a note of the current at 7 volts because the minimum you want to go to is at 7 volts. It needs to deliver a reasonable amount of current at the 7 volts to be able to start the car. Anyway, I'll admit the next series of video, it's 10 minutes of me showing you testing all of these, sometimes multiple tests of them. I state the various voltages and the crank amps that they achieved. If you find this boring, jump to the end of the video or go to my website and look at the chart there. But some of you may find it interesting. In these videos though, you will see where some of them burst into smoke, notably the two that were sent to me, where you can hear them creaking, one pops. And then I do a final test on the Stanley Jumpit because it initially couldn't deliver even the 500 amps. Remember, it's claiming 1,000 amps peak. It couldn't deliver 500 amps. I then, after multiple tests on this, recharged it overnight and did a final crank up to see if I could just achieve that 500 amps, even for a short time. I'll let you watch the video to find that out. I will, a little spoiler alert, and it has to be a spoiler alert, the only one that was able to at least for a very short period of time match its claimed crank amps was the Anker without failing. Under heavy load, once it had had too much load, it automatically disconnected, and you'll see that in the video. It didn't overload itself to the point of failure. So I feel out of the devices here, which are the safest, obviously was the Genius Boost, the Anchor, the Stanley never failed, it's very well built, and I'll give you a quick video as I end off showing you the build quality of these good devices, not the others. Don't bother with them. Enjoy the video, catch you at the end of that. Smoke. There you go. I'm gonna count that as a fail. I'm sorry, you don't want things smoking and smelling and then dying on you. So that is the end of the arch year. Whoa! Explosion! That was at about 170 or so amps. We'll review the video. It looks like the actual battery pack has exploded. I'll carefully disconnect all of it and then we'll have a look at it. Here we go. I heard an explosion inside the unit. You can see the unit is actually split open, and that was nowhere near its full load capacity.
Okay, so the Stanley has been starting fine, although the amps are obviously lower at the kind of 7-volt threshold. So this is going to be a 500 amp test. So it's not its peak 1000 amp, it is its 500 amp test. Going to take the voltage down as low as it goes just to see if it can maintain 500 amp for about 5 seconds. Answer to that is no. Gets nowhere near now. It's obviously shot. Okay, I'm going to put this back on charge. Showing 2 bars when I look at it. We'll put it back on charge and see if I can come back and do a 500 amp test. Could hear some crackling on that. Okay, the next test on the power bolt, it's gone through 5 cycles already. What I want to do is crank it up to kind of, let's say around 200 to 300 amp, just to make sure it's not going to fail critically. Crackle. Okay, about 270, 200, making noises. Does not sound good. Yeah, looking at the case, I can see there's a little bit of change in the enclosure here, and it feels like the battery inside has swollen. I can feel pressure building up on the outside, so that does not feel good at all. Okay, so for our last test, I fully charged the Stanley Jumpit. The temperature here today, it's the next day, we're sitting around 3 or 4 degrees Celsius, so it's fairly chilly again. And what I want to see now is whether the Stanley has any chance of delivering near its 500 amps. So I'm going to crank it up fairly quickly to see if it can deliver the 500 amp even for a short period of time. There we go. Right, have you made it this far? Okay, if you have, I'm going to take you onto the bench quickly just to show you the 3 which I think are perhaps worthy of trying to use. As I said, I'm now going to do a more realistic test with trying to start a vehicle or a car, and that video I'm going to have posted, I say, on that link where the table is of the results of these tests. That video I'm going to have there on my website. I'm going to end off with a little chit chat explaining my other concerns about these devices and why I've taken so much time talking and researching this video in particular. But let's go onto the bench and have a closer look. Okay, now that we're at the bench and I can kind of show you these, I just want to quickly show you these manuals before I show you the devices. So these are the devices I certainly don't recommend. I'm going to talk a little about these companies and the concern I have. I've now almost decided I'm not going to receive equipment anymore from companies like this, and I'll explain that when I wrap up the video. But here you go. This was the Archer manual. As you can see, it kind of initially all starts off in Mandarin. So initially you're kind of thinking, well, where is the English that I have to read?
And then you have to come inside here with text, which is not that great. And they've got these little diagrams over here. Now these diagrams, in my opinion, should be printed on the device, not tucked away in something like this, which is potentially going to get lost and certainly not pulled out in a state of emergency or panic. Same for the Best Tech. If we have a look inside this, you have to page through to find the English, and the text here is perhaps even smaller. And again, in my mind, you really need good, clear, big descriptive diagrams so there's no confusion in setting up these devices. And I'm harping on about that because these devices contain a lot of energy, and if that energy is released quickly, it can be very dangerous. Right, so let's go ahead and have a look at the anchor. Now, the one thing you'll have heard me not mention is the other features, the fact that they've got, let's say, USB for charging your phone and a flashlight. Now, the flashlight, of course, could be useful at night. So I'll say most of these have flashlights, and that's a nice handy tool. Yes, they've got USB for charging your phone or your tablet, but don't buy one of these to charge your phone or tablet. If you're gonna use the power out of this to do that, when it really comes to needing this in an emergency, you're not going to have the energy. They're already struggling to provide the energy to start your car. You don't want to sap it away by charging your smart devices. So that's why I'm not even going into the fact that they've got USB outputs. They have an on-off switch. That does not switch the main current that starts your car. Right? So this is not made safe. This is live right now. This will short if I connect something across it. I'll just show you. They are set back, but nonetheless, there are the metal points. If this happened to go missing or was open or what have you, there's a lot of potential energy sitting right there. So the anchor, it's got a nice rubbery feel to it. It feels reasonably robust. When we get to the Genius or the Noco Genius, I think it's got a better build than this. But nonetheless, in terms of safety, even though the safety is outboard on this, its overload protection worked and its short circuit protection works. So basically, this will not make these crocodile clips live unless it sees a voltage on the battery terminals. So once it sees a voltage on the battery terminals, it'll eventually go like a solid green. So it'll be blinking initially, I think goes red, then goes flashing green, then it'll go solid green once it can see a voltage, and then goes, right, I'm connected, I'm safe. What happens if your battery doesn't have enough voltage? Well, that's where it's got the override. You can push the override. But of course, you use that at your own risk. You've got to be wary that you're then making these crocodile clips live. It takes away the intelligence. These are of reasonable quality. They're not that great. They're plastic. They will do the job for the emergency. It does come in this nice little carry pouch, zip up, fairly convenient to store. It'll protect it. Here's the flap where it's stored on the other side. It comes with, I say, this AC adapter. I'd advise obviously doing this every 6 months or a year if you want to ensure you're safe. It comes with this one you can use in your car. Don't be tempted to plug this into your car and permanently leave this so that you think it's always going to be ready and charged. Some of these charging circuits may not be the best. I did not test that. And if they're not the best, you know there's enough history with toy devices where the lithium charging circuit is not up to spec, and you suddenly get batteries bursting or what have you. So you want to be really careful. And I'll make a note when we get to the Stanley, there's a case even with that you have to be careful. So don't charge it in your car. I'd almost be tempted to throw this away. Take it into your house once every 6 months to a year and charge it there. So that's the anchor. Then we get to the Genius Boost. What's a nice little case. It feels robust. It feels like you could bang it around. It's not going to break apart. It's screwed together. Nice, solid, robust clips that cover up. Yes, it's got a USB out. There's the USB for charging it. Great. They provide it with a nice little Noco USB charger and a cable as well. It doesn't come with a case, however. It comes with this little soft sock bag that you put in. But you know what? This is so robust, and this makes it a really small little package with all the bits in there. It might make it easy to store.
but perhaps the nice little hard case that Anker provide would have been a nice addition. But a great little device. It's got its power switch on the front here. You switch it on. It's got these LEDs which indicate the state of charge. It's got a warning light which will tell you if it's on low voltage or cannot charge, or if there's a reverse polarity. There's a warning light that comes on over here. And this is the torch or flashlight button. You can set it to do various things for you. And then it's got the override button. So if you need to override because you either don't have a battery and directly connecting it to start a car, that could be an interesting scenario I'm probably going to test. Or the battery voltage is too low and you need to override, you merely hold that down for a bit and bang. You'll hear that click. The relay has now energized the output and it's saying it's ready to start. But you really do have to override that to override the safety systems. But otherwise, a great device, literally a great solid build device. It just came really short on delivering anywhere near its claims. You can see it actually says the 1000 amp at 12 volt, which I believe it'll deliver for a split second. It's claiming, if I'm reading this correctly, and they don't note this anywhere else, like at 7,000 joules, 3S. What does that 3S mean? I would assume that means 3 seconds. Not a chance is it going to do 1000 amp 12 volt for that duration. It can't do 500 amp for 3 seconds, okay? This, if I remember correctly, was delivering around the 180 to 200 plus mark. That'll be in the table on my spreadsheet. So that was with my carbon pile load tester, which is a heavy test on here, which I still personally think is a fair test to make sure that they should have held that current for a lot longer than they did. But we'll see if it actually starts a car. I say, and that video will be on my website. Now, before I go to the Stanley, the one thing I forgot to show you were the clips that come with the Genius Boost. Wow. Talk about quality and heavy gauge. Nice, heavy copper. They've got a good crimping of the cable in the front over there. Really nice and solid. Nice, good, flexible cables. They are silicone by the feel of things. It's 8 gauge, rated for 200 degrees Celsius. And this thing, as in terms of the testing, you'll have noted it cut off before it got overloaded, so it protects itself that way. Got a nice heavy duty plug which goes in, nicely recessed. It's got even a cover for that. Everything about this, barring it being able to hold a current, is excellent. It's just a pity it couldn't hold that current, but still, we'll do the test on the vehicle to see whether it can actually start a vehicle without a battery. Now we get to the Stanley Jumper. And I say it's obviously not a mini jump starter. It's still a portable car jump starter. Very simple in its operation. It does have a USB and 12 volt output here. You can also charge it. They provide you with a car cigarette lighter to car cigarette lighter cable, so you can charge this in your car. However, do you want to do that? No. They also say that after I think it's 6 or so many hours, you have to check the manual, disconnect it, because I don't think that this directly charges the battery. Perhaps no charging circuit to stop the charging when it reaches the right voltage. So you have to be very wary in that regard. The USB, you've got a switch to switch on the USB over there. You can check the battery status, and then this manual switch. It's got a warning if you are reverse polarity. It has a little dinky light. I think they could have done a bit better with this little light. I don't think it's going to be easy to use because it's not an extension and attached here, but I suppose better than nothing. If you're charging this at home, you put an extension cable and link it to the power that way. It does have a built-in compressor. I tested this. I dropped the reading, first of all, the pressure reading on this gauge is reasonably accurate. It's not far off at all, perhaps 0.1 of a bar. You can pump your tires. It took me about 7 minutes to take a car tire from 1 bar to 2.3 bar. So it can certainly do the job at a push. I wouldn't use this. I wouldn't try and do all 4 tires. I think they say it can do like 3 tires, you know, if it's got to top them up. But nonetheless, in winter, I've been in that situation where my tire pressures were too low. If I had this in the car, it would have been a great God save at the time. It's got some nice, meaty, chunky metal jump starter crocodile clips. It's got nice, meaty cables. even when I pushed this to that current, when I pushed it to, I think it, what was it, 400 and something amps, these were only slightly warm afterwards. So these held out very well indeed. You can wrap them around the sides, and then you can, you've obviously got these spots on the side that you can hold it there. And inside there'll be one of those little sealed lead acid batteries. So it's far less risk in terms of a lithium battery which might explode. So I think certainly for in your garage, if you're in an emergency and have to jump start your vehicle and no one else is around to be able to do it, this could do the job. If you've got a big truck or a big SUV, then you might actually have space in the back of your car for this. And this potentially might be something that I actually would rather store in my car than a lithium battery. But anyway, let's wrap it up. Okay, have you made it this far? A lot of talking in this video, but I've got a little more to say. Why do I do so much talking in a video like this when in theory you could just quickly whip them out on the bench and go, here we go, this one might start your car. That's what a lot of other people are doing. And I think in particular with products like these, there's one, the claims out there and the reviews on Amazon, so many of them are bogus. I now, after doing these tests, would be very hesitant to buy a device like this off Amazon, going on the reviews there. Why? There's one thing, you know, like when I go and test solar panels and they don't live up to their claims, they're not gonna hurt you. There's not a safety issue there. Where with these devices, there's definitely a safety issue. Batteries bursting or expanding or the safety cable thing heating up and smoking, that is not good. There's lots of energy in these devices. They need to be safe. That's why the companies which sent me those two devices, don't touch them. And I'll just say, the reason why I'm potentially not going to receive any more devices from companies like these, and I'll explain, and I'm sure they're going to be upset with what I've got to say. What they do is that I get, and I don't joke, I probably get 3 to 5 emails a day from these companies saying, please won't you review this, please won't you do this, or what have you. And I just shove them aside. Because I was doing these jumpstart tests and these happened to fall into my inbox, I thought, okay, it's going to save me a few bucks. Let them send them to me. What they do, they say, oh, great, we're really looking forward to your review. They send you the device with, and they've got tracking on it. Now, I don't receive stuff at my home. It goes to my PO box. My PO box at UPS, they sign for it. And that then sends a signal back to say it's been received. As soon as these companies, particularly the one, got a signal saying it had been received, they then send you an email saying, oh, you have to do this. You have to put these links in your video. You have to put the name of our product in the title of your video. You suddenly get a whole lot of stipulations that you have to do a video to. Does my head in. So I'm not going to do this again. I'm not going to receive these devices and then be told what I have to do. I turned around and I said, you know what? I haven't got it in my hands yet. Send me your address, I'm going to return it to you. And they go, oh no, please do an honest review. Well, that my honest review is, don't touch them with a barge pole. They're dangerous, okay? And as I said, looking at the reviews on Amazon, many are paid for. Many of the devices are not tested properly to see how safe they are. So, it's a minefield. Honestly, it's a minefield trying to pick one of these devices. I would probably, with a reasonable amount of certainty, say that the Genius Boost and the Anker seem like safe devices in my testing. The concern is, do you want to have a lithium battery in a hot car? I'd be keen to hear your comments. I personally actually am a little concerned about that. I may end up having one of those devices in my vehicle, but I'm really conscious about the risks of a lithium battery in a car that could get very, very hot. Anyway, enough jabbering from me. Hopefully that's given you some guideline as to these devices. And I think it's more of a case of just be buyer beware. Be very careful of what you're buying out there. I wish there was some testing or safety standard on these devices where you could have a better judgment rather than even relying on a YouTuber like me. But I'll do my best to do the testing that I can on these and update that table as soon as I have more devices, which I think are, well, I'm gonna certainly note the ones which have failed, so at least you can be aware of those. But go to my website, see that list, you'll see all the stats and figures there. And then in the follow-up video that'll also be posted there, my hope is to attempt to start a car with the battery disconnected to see how well they fare there and how many times they can start, because many of these are claiming 20 or 25 jump starts off a single charge. Ha ha, I doubt it, but we'll see. Anyway, thanks for watching the video and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.